Thanks, Eric. So our final speaker for the morning is Dave Patterson. He is from Berkeley as well. He was director of the Rad Lab before the AMP Lab, where Matei and I were grad students, and a lot of the people from the Spark community were from this community of labs. Dave has moved to working on a popular problem, and he's addressing it in a new way. He's bringing to bear Spark on the problem of genomics, and not just Spark, but the computer science mentality in general. So it's exciting to hear from Dave about his thoughts on a higher level application of a technology like Spark.
All right, thanks. So what I'm going to talk to you about today is something that matters a lot in your lives, whether you realize it or not. I'm going to talk about cancer. So why should you care about cancer? Cancer will soon be the leading cause of death in the United States. It will affect 1 in 3 women in her lifetime and 1 in 2 men. So you, your friends, your family are going to be affected by this terrible disease, and we're going to talk about what we're doing to try and help. And it's using Spark. And in there, I'll give you a little genomics 101 and tell you how you can help us help people. So the idea is, you read about what's happening in genetics all the time, and kind of when we were talking about it in the beginnings of the AMP Lab, is kind of this provocative argument. Could people like us, who know how to build software, learn a little biology and really help out with this genetic diseases like cancer? And in fact, as we talked about it in the group, suppose we did something that saved somebody's life. That could justify a whole career. Or suppose maybe we could save 100 lives. Or since biology is a process that keeps happening to people, it's not going to go away, you might be able to do something that saved 100 lives a year. And as one of the guys worked this, but that would justify your whole career if that's all you did. All right, so that was a fun idea to talk about. But as I wrote in the op-ed piece in the New York Times 3 years ago, kind of in the middle of the night after we came up with that idea, it was kind of, oh my God. I don't know if it's true or not that people like us can help people, but there's a chance that they can. And if there's a chance, how can we as moral people not try? So that's what got us started on this journey. So I'm gonna tell you a couple of stories about this. Earlier this month, there was an article in the New York Times and the New England Journal of Medicine about this boy, Joshua Osborne. He's 14 years old. He was having headaches and fevers. He kept going to doctors. They didn't know what to do. He lived in Wisconsin, so they took him to the best research hospital there, the University of Wisconsin. They had to check him into the hospital, and for 5 weeks, they couldn't figure out what's wrong with him. They even did a brain biopsy, where they took 1 cubic centimeter of brain out to try and figure it out. They couldn't figure out what's wrong. He soon developed water on the brain, and then he had kind of consistent seizures, so they were forced to put him into a medically induced coma to preserve his life. And so in desperation, they talked to the parents, hey, there's this thing, experimental program at UCSF, we'd like to try that with your permission. So they took a sample of cerebral spinal fluid, FedExed it to UCSF, right a couple of miles from here. They used genetic sequence to sequence it. And then what they have was, if these 5,000 squares represent that, what they would do before is guess what was wrong and look for it. But what they did instead is they used this our program that we developed called SNAP to find the needle in the haystack by removing all the hay. And what was left was the needle. So it removed all the human reads, and what was left there is 0.2% of the reads that were left were this rare bacteria. So within 48 hours after sending the samples, they ran the SNAP in another program, which just took about an hour and a half, and they were able to get a phone call back to the Wisconsin doctor. Says, we've identified this rare bacteria. There's some standard antibiotics you can give to the kid. So they gave it to Joshua, and he awoke from his coma in a week, and he was walking in 2 weeks and released to his family in 4 weeks. So, which we were very excited about. But not only that, it's a broader thing. What Joshua has is called encephalitis. It's a brain swelling. There's 15,000 cases a year. Most of these are children. about 2,000 deaths a year, and 70% of these are underdiagnosed. They don't really know what happened. So that means like 4 people a day die from encephalitis in the United States, and they don't know why it happened. So Charles Hsu at UCSF said not only for encephalitis, about either somewhere between 0.1 and 1% of all hospital patients in the United States, they don't really know what's wrong with them. So with 35 million, you can multiply that out and how many people are involved. So what Charles Hsu is setting up at UCSF is going to use SNAP in conjunction with a laboratory test. And this is his priority here and the things that happen. You see, the encephalitis case that we just talked about is only third in his priority list. And then they're also going to distribute this software. It's open source software, like everything associated with the AmpLab, to both academic hospitals and a bunch of public agencies like the American Red Cross and the Center for Disease Control and the California Public Health. All right, so that's my first story. The second story, because we got excited about this in big part because of cancer, is we started working with this guy, Brian Druker. In this newspaper article, we calls him the hero on the hill. So he works in Portland at the Oregon Health Sciences University, which is on a hill overlooking Portland. He's the hero on the hill because he found a type of leukemia, chronic myeloid leukemia, that was triggered by a single gene mutation, and he kind of browbeat the pharma industry to release a drug that would work on this single mutation, which is 5,000 patients a year. And it worked. It was on the cover of Time magazine 13 years ago. So thousands of patients a year, people live a year because of what he did. After the success of CML, he wanted to work on another type of leukemia that had had no progress, he said, in the last 30, 40 years. About 30 or 40% of the people survive. Let's take on acute myeloid leukemia, which is 9,000 patients a year. So we met with them, and the way I've described what he was going to do with it is taking Petri dishes that has either bone marrow or blood, and then he was going to try the various cancer drugs on them one at a time and with all these Petri dishes to see which ones would work for an individual patient. Now, everybody believes that AML was not a single gene that's mutated, that's multiple genes, and everybody believes that there's no way a single drug is going to save a person's life. It'll extend life a bit. The pharma companies make their money by extending life by 3 or 6 months and then charging many tens of thousands of dollars for that, but it's not really cure them. So when we asked him, why are you doing this? Because he's a forward-thinking guy, he says, well, geez, if we did the combination of drugs, there's just too many for us to figure out. And he said, well, machine learning, computer science, data, we're here to help. Let's try. So a group of us have been meeting. The goal is that what we'll do is develop a program that'll look at the person's characteristics and the genotype and propose drug combinations for that candidate. In the beginning, it's kind of the P part of the AmpLab. It's people are doing that because we got to figure out how to do it ourselves before we can get a program. So we've brainstormed twice, multi-day brainstorming with the OHSU people and the Berkeley AmpLab folk to try and figure out what to do. And I'll tell you about the progress we've made so far. So this is what doctor's view of genetics. So the rows here is about mutations, about 30 gene mutations, and the columns are patients, about 200. So you can see which mutations happen in combination for each patient. And the little thing at the bottom shows their likelihood of survival, with white being very favorable, red being very unfavorable, and pink being in between. So that data didn't make a lot of sense to us. So we did a data-driven approach. What we did was we started from all the mutations, and I think we invented this diagram. I think we're going to call it a mutation tree. But the root of that tree is the most frequently mutated gene. And if it goes to the left, it's mutated. And if it goes to the right, it's not mutated. And it's got everything in there that's more than 1%. So this is the way the data. Then we found for each of these categories of the subtrees what was that not favorable, unfavorable, what was the 5-year survival rate, which is the standard test. And so you see the little green one was a 10% survival rate, the other ones were 50%, and so on as we went across. And the first thing we did when we presented this data this way is we realized if any of us got AML, we would want to know which triangle we were in to see if we're at the 10% chance, maybe we want to try something more experimental, or the 80% we'll stick with the standard care. And then we labeled this by the frequency of patients. So that's kind of how far we got, but one of the people in the group came up with a theory for this, the 5% of patients. So this is 250 or 300 people die a year of this one, and he has a theory. There's an alpha version of the gene that's mutated that leads to the AML. There's a beta version that's kind of a backup that you can invoke with if, like, you get a bit of infection or something. So we think maybe that would work. We looked in the literature. We actually found a case of a Japanese woman who had both AML and pneumonia. Since she's going to die of pneumonia, they treated the pneumonia. And it probably she had, for that type of AML, had that mutation. And the treatment of the pneumonia, the reason they wrote the paper about it is we treated her for pneumonia, and after the pneumonia was gone, she was cured of AML. We don't know what happened, but that would be consistent with this theory. We've read some other recent research papers that are also consistent. So it's tomorrow, we're getting up early and flying to Portland to meet with them some more, and we're going to talk to the oncologists and see what they think of this. But you know, so it's too early to know, you know, for the original, the SNAP case, the pathogen identification, could it save 100 lives a year? You know, we'll find out over the next few years. Will this work? It's too early to know, but over the next few years, we'll know about that. So you don't need a medical degree to do this. We work with people with medical degrees. That cartoon guide to genetics, that's the deep knowledge I have in genetics, is in that cartoon guide. The other book that we read, which is a Pulitzer Prize winning book, is The Emperor of All Maladies. It talks about the whole life of cancer and how it's affected people, and they try to fight it over the centuries, and it also helps us explain it. And then, you know, in the last few years, you've also read the newspapers about these massive open online courses. So for free, we could get really great courses to learn about biology on our own, and many of us have taken these courses. Some of us have taken more than others. In fact, the person who came up with the theory about the AML had taken some more serious courses and had an idea from that. Okay, now let's do the genetics 101. Those of you who like jigsaw puzzles, that's you would like working in this area. Billions of pieces, and we actually kind of know what the cover of the box looks like. So here's an analogy that we got from Michael Schatz. So suppose Charles Dickens, because you know he understands about dependability and the way you make things dependable is make copies. When he wrote A Tale of Two Cities, he made five copies, redundant copies, written on spools of paper. Alas, what was a good thing he did that, because it got broken up, each of those spools, into five word segments. So the challenge then would be how to recreate that. So in this case, it's, you know, 14,000 of these words, so 140,000 segments. So what's hard about this? Well, some of the segments are identical, even though they're in different parts of the story, so you have to get it right. And what's really hard about it is it's not all lined up like that. These segments are laying there on the floor, lots of copies laying there on the floor, and you have to reassemble A Tale of Two Cities. So that analogy explains a whole lot of lingo here. So we don't have 26 letters in DNA. We have four letters. Those are called bases. And a human being has about 3 billion of these letters or bases. These fragments are called reads. Now, instead of being five words, they tend to be about 150 letters or 150 bases. So there's like 20 million reads for each of these spools. The spools make sense, too, because what the genetic sequencing machines do is they make copies. And the more copies, the greater depth. And that's called coverage. So they typically do 60 spools there. So 600 million reads is what you have to reassemble. The reference, there's a generic 3 billion base reference, which is kind of the puzzle box cover. That's what you're trying to match against. And the step that's called alignment, and SNAP is an aligner, tries to match the human reads to that reference. And we're all different, like one in 1,000 bases are different, and that's called, the differences are called variants, and the process of finding variants is called variant calling. So that helps you, you can read a lot of papers from that. So we sit, the big data lab, why do we need big data for genetics? And this gives an example. A scientific study said, is schizophrenia based on genetic mutations? Does that explain it? And a regional hospital, with only 7,000 samples, the red line meant it was statistically significant, and their conclusion would have been, no, there's no genetic relationship with schizophrenia. But by collaborating with other researchers around the world, over time they were getting up to get 50,000 samples, and when you got to 50,000 samples, they found 60 mutations that could be associated with schizophrenia. So we went from no to yes, and there's a lot of things work by collecting the data together. So why are we going to get a lot of data? This is something only billionaires could afford to do. every talk that you'll see a chart like this, it's improved dramatically faster than Moore's law. A factor of 100,000 in a dozen years or so in the cost reduction. This year is expected to cost $1,000 to get your genome sequence. This is widely believed to be the tipping point where many people could afford to do it if we had good medical benefits from it. So the software that analyzes this, there's the wet lab piece, those are expensive machines, and that part is $1,000. What about the software that processes it? A popular software pipeline, like what was talked about earlier, it comes from the Broad Institute, and we're making an open source version of every one of those pieces, for the same reasons we make Spark open source. So SNAP is this alignment program, open source out there right now, that does the alignment. There's a bunch of steps that we have to do called the variant, and that's a program called ATOM, and I'll talk about in a little detail. We are developing programs that are distributed, cloud-friendly programs, Spark-based, that'll do variant calling, and then you've already heard about ML-based and GraphX, which can do some higher-level processing. Okay, so how big is this? For a single genome, each of these steps are hundreds of gigabytes, so a fraction of a terabyte, but we need to get to tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, or millions of them, so that gets us up to the petabyte ranges. So what was novel about SNAP from kind of a computer science perspective? It's, first of all, very accurate and much faster than anything else out there, which was why we could help save Joshua's life. It takes advantage of the big memory to have larger overlapping seeds. It uses a fancier string matching algorithm called Ukkonen. And I should mention, who worked on this paper? Matei. You probably know Matei from Spark. He was one of the authors of these ideas, and I think he came up with the idea of using the Ukkonen algorithm. And it has some other features for indexing that make it go really fast. The ATOM pipeline is something, of course, it's cloud friendly. It works on any of the clouds. These files, the genetic information, are giant files, so it's great for using the Hadoop file system. How we do the records handling, we have a schema-based approach so that everything is compatible and works in lots of languages using Avro. We're using Parquet, the columnar store. That's a great match for genetics. We can get compression kind of for free, and as often you're dealing just with individual genes that you want to do optimization of that so you can speed things up. And then Apache Spark, keeping things in memory. You can query in SQL using Spark SQL, and then GraphX and ML-based. So how old? ATOM is just a little over a year old, and it's already catching on. It's just 20,000 lines of Scala. It's like everything we do is open source. We've already have 17 contributors from all of these organizations, and we have 4 proof of concept implementations outside of Berkeley where people are trying to use this to process genetic information. Our friends at the Broad Institute who have built these things were very impressed with a technical report that we could get things done this fast. So I'll show you that next slide. So the thing I really want to emphasize in this slide is, as a computer architect, I'm used to the y-axis being the seconds or minutes. This is hours, right? So this is what it takes, the way the old system was, fractions of a day to sort, right? And these are the three steps. So the big thing about ATOM isn't only that it's faster on a single node. We want something we can use the cloud to make things faster and cheaper so we can get things done quick enough to help people. So the three steps you'd have to do before you can do the variant calling run 50 times faster using EC2. Now, this is the part we're talking about you can help. So, I'm interested, Dave, but I don't want to take the time to read the cartoon guide to genetics. Can I help right now? Yes! Yes, you can. Our website is bdgenomics, so bigdatagenomics.org. You can get on the mailing list, the IRC channel, and if you'd like to help out, if you know how to program, there's things that you can do to program to help out. And, that's great for volunteering, but how can I get paid to help? What can I get paid to help to do? Well, look, if you want to help make rich people richer, go work for Lehman Brothers, okay? If that's what you want to do, help rich people get richer, go do that. But if you want to help save lives, some sick people who need your help, come to Berkeley. We have two openings for programmers. You get to work with really bright people. You get to work on a university campus. The Berkeley campus is a pretty campus. And, you know, you get to work with a top-rated computer systems department. You know, in the newspapers, it sounds like MIT or Stanford. It's not. The top-rated department is at Berkeley, and you get to work with us. Everything's open source. You'd be highly visible in the community. We even pay competitive salaries, including signing bonuses. And we're not going to go out of business like the Lehman Brothers. We're not going to go out of business. So if you're interested, I'll be around here. You can send me an email. Matt Massey, who's leading this effort, is about a foot taller than I am, and he's easy to really spot. But I'll be happy to talk to you and look forward to help. And we'd like to thank all of our collaborators that let us work on this exciting thing. I've been in this field for a while. I think there's nothing as exciting as trying to help people save lives. I'm still amazed today that people like us can really help. But if you're interested, come talk to us.
Thanks, Dave. So before we break for lunch, which we'll do in just a moment, I want to make the announcement that this is the end of the morning session. The afternoon session will be in three tracks. This is track